Welcome to Korea and the World, a podcast on political, economic, and social issues from the perspective of the Korean Peninsula.
South Korea's culture scene is booming, and Seoul is steadily establishing itself as a regional and increasingly global hotspot for design, fashion, and music. Our guest for this episode, Tom Buscheman, is a household name in the Korean creative scene. Originally from Germany and now based in Korea, he is the co-founder and CEO of Platoon, a creative network that brings together designers, artists, movie directors, photographers, and many other creative minds. In Korea, Platoon is arguably best known for its Kunsthalle, an art space in Seoul's Gangnam neighborhood that has become a social and cultural landmark. It provides a platform for hip crowds, young artists, and changemakers from all horizons while hosting communication events for some of the world's major brands. Tom kindly agreed to talk to us about Seoul's artistic and cultural ecosystem and how he and his business partners decided to set up shop in Korea almost a decade ago. Tom Buscheman, welcome to Korea and the World.
It's a pleasure to be here today.
When did you come to Korea for the first time and what brought you here initially?
In 2006. I was here the first time in May 2006, which is 10 years next year. And we met Koreans in Berlin, end of 2005. Told them about our plans to extend to Asia with a platoon. And they immediately invited us to come over to have a closer look at Seoul. I guess that was the beginning of the whole story. So we took this invitation and came over in May 2006 the first time.
Actually, your adventure starts in 1999 when you start Platoon with your friend Christoph Frank. Could you maybe tell us in a few words what Platoon is and what motivated you to get that project starting?
At the time when I met Christoph, we were both still busy in the marketing, advertising and consulting industry in Germany. So we both worked with two small agencies, but separately. But we were a little bit tired on this classic communication, advertising and marketing business. But we wanted to stay in this field, but with a new approach and a new project. So we developed then in 1999 Platoon Cultural Development. And let's say the main vision here behind is using creatives to conceptualize and to realize communication approaches, campaigns, projects, together with brands. Because at that time, we felt like brands and their engagement in marketing, advertising, and cultural activities, they have a strong responsibility to exactly these young creatives, which we see everywhere around the globe. So the aim was to create a new hybrid, which is very close to the young, upcoming subculture-related artists and creatives. On the other hand, because we were professional enough, already established in this business, so the bridge between these young people and big brands. That's where we wanted to place our Platoon Cultural Development as a platform in between, because they will never get in touch directly. So we saw our chance and our task here to build a platform so we could stay still with brands and doing things, nice creative things for brands, but using really the young, upcoming, fresh, crazy, open-minded people from tomorrow. That was in the end the idea. Simply build it up in a global perspective, so having touch points everywhere around the globe. We started in Berlin for the European continent. It was a plan to go to Asia, after Asia, Mexico City for the American continent. Now we start considering about Africa, what would be the city for us in Africa. So having these offline places where people really can meet and do things together and which we can use as a platform, as I said before. And building around an online network as well with creative recruits, which we think fits to us and our interest. So that was in the end the main idea here. And if it comes to architecture, it's also pretty easy. In every city, we have a lot of empty slots. No matter what downtown, you can always find some empty spots. And we wanted to use these empty slots temporarily to show off with our network, with our creative program. So that's why we decided to go for a container architecture from the beginning and use container as a symbol of flexibility in the end.
Not only does the concept of Platoon, well, let's say, differ from the average advertising agency, but also your website is, to say the least, quite obscure. It's really hard to know what you're actually doing there. Is that on purpose, right?
That's on purpose, absolutely. I mean, you can't compare us with an advertising agency. First of all, I hate this word, advertising. It's something which is dead, you know? So we are not interested in classic advertising from the beginning. We are the creative agency. We can think for a client or a project or any kind of institution in terms of developing or creating creative concept, a creative campaign, a creative platform, a creative event series or exhibition concept. For us, it's more, it's about creativity here. Advertising, that's something we don't even want to be compared anymore. Mainstream business advertising. Yeah, these are big budgets with big global players in charge of multi-million dollars in every single country, and they simply have to make numbers. That's not what we are interested in. Yeah, we are doing the whipped cream of communication approaches, which is really like creatives. That's where we see our strengths in the end. So you will never see us doing a 30 seconds TV commercial for any kind of consumer related goods, Procter & Gamble or something. So this is not our business, because in this field you can't really be so creative like we want to be. We are creatives, a creative network with the most creative people around, and we're claiming right now already that we have the most creative network around the globe. Name me one network which claims it's a creative network which is bigger, more interesting, or more creative than us. That's our clear statement here.
Could you maybe tell us one project you're especially proud of? It doesn't need to be a big one, just something that you really liked in terms of creativity, in terms of involvement.
Okay, in Korea, that's totally easy. When we started Platoon Kunsthalle in April 2009, we already worked 2 years as a creative agency for Adidas. So I mentioned in the beginning these Koreans we met in Berlin. These were the trend and lifestyle marketing team from Adidas Korea who were invited to a global happening in Berlin. And this global happening happened on our yard in Berlin. So at that time, we already worked for Adidas. Then we came to Korea and Adidas hired us as a creative agency, as a creative bank, idea bank and think tank starting from 2007 on. So we developed different concepts and ideas, but probably the biggest one, which every Korean still got in his mind, is 60 years of Soles and Stripes. That was the anniversary of Adidas, 60 years of Adidas, 2009. And what we did is we created a campaign, a house party concept and campaign, and kicked it off in March 2009, which means like 1 month before we officially opened the Kunsthalle, we opened this venue for a 3 days event, which was the kickoff of a 60 years yearly campaign for Korea. So we had 3 days in a row, a house party concept at Kunsthalle, with a lot of activities, artists, live stage, and so on and so on. But we also developed a consumer-related campaign, and it was a wonderful concept where people could apply with for a party promotion package worth $10,000. So you could apply with the best party concept will be sponsored by the brand. And it was always about birthday. And then we built up a microsite for that, so people could apply. Of course, we named 5 winners or 6 winners, I don't know exactly anymore. And then we as an agency, we organized with this winner together his one and only party. So one was, for example, I will never forget that, on the area where usually the Pentaport Rock Festival happens. And there was a birthday from a girl, so we organized a small private rock festival for her and her friends. There was like 100 guests invited, and we had a small stage, different groups, bands, barbecue and stuff like this. So we did the same then also like connected to some shops from Adidas. So we've been to Jeju, we've been to Busan, we did it here in Seoul as well. So I think this 60 years of Swords and Stripes, that was an amazing campaign. And our feedback from Adidas at that time, and still I think, they said it was the most successful event or campaign they ever rolled out in Korea until that time. It's funny because during the sweet days, I guess we had like easy 3,000 visitors, and Adidas at that time was already kind of cool. They had their own network, so a lot of cool people came, a lot of artists, creatives and stuff. So they all still have this in their mind. So I can go even today, wherever I go, a lot of people will be reminded on this specific campaign and event, which was connected to our place, Kunsthalle.
Kunsthalle, could you tell us more about it? What is it really?
I guess I mentioned in the beginning, Platoon Cultural Development with a network and the positioning of being a platform in between brands and the subculture related artists. So, of course, you need a space for that. If you want to be a platform, you need a physical platform, a stage. That was our idea when we came to Korea, to establish the first time a space where all these creatives can meet and mingle and where we can support these creatives. So we came up with the term Platoon Kunsthalle, and that was the kickoff here in Seoul. And Kunsthalle is the term for art hall, it's a German term, it's nothing more than art hall. The term Kunsthalle was invented in the late 50s in Germany. There was the first Kunsthalle invented by the guys around Paik Nam-jung, Josef Beuys, Richter, Vostell, all these big artist names. They created the first Kunsthalle in Düsseldorf end of the 50s. And we felt like, because Paik Nam-jung was really a center of this artist group in the late 50s, so we thought, wow, nothing fits better to Korea then the term Kunsthalle. We can even have this bridge to Paik Nam-jung here. That's somehow the reason why we came up with this Platoon Kunsthalle name and concept here in Korea. And what is it, Kunsthalle? I guess some of your audience have experienced it in the past years, but it's a building made out of containers, 28 containers in total, and it's a multi-purpose room. So we have a huge hall, but also four artists in lab studios. So we invited twice a year four artists to use these studios for a half year to do whatever they want there. We supported them even with a small production budget for either some activities within this half year, or often they had an exhibition at the end of the 6 months, which we then produced and promoted. Of course, we also had offices there, but one room was a bit bigger room. It's called Think Tank, so which was supposed to be used by smaller workshops, artist lectures, creative lectures and stuff like this. So that's roughly the concept of Kunsthalle. So we had a lot of events there from all different directions. So all the creative scene in Seoul could apply for using it as long as it was a non-commercial event. We never charged any money, so we simply gave them the platform to express themselves, but also, of course, to get in touch closer with our creative network. So that was, in the end, the win-win situation for us, giving them the stage, but being then, on the other hand, also very tightly connected to this creative community here in Korea. That was our main target. Yeah, we wanted to have all the big creative names from Korea connected to us. And that worked pretty well out. So we had minimum 100 events a year, a lot of bigger events with 1,000 plus guests, but also smaller ones. We invented wonderful, beautiful concepts like Night Flea Market. That was really one of the first concepts we developed and launched pretty soon after we opened the space in 2009. I guess the first flea market was in October 2009. So once a month, an open space, everybody could come and everybody could register themselves as a seller. So we had 60, 70, 80 sellers in the whole Kunsthalle building, and we open it every first Saturday a month for the evening into the night with DJs and a bit more other atmosphere than a regular flea market, which you anyway at that time couldn't see in Korea. So it was also like something new we brought into this country in 2009. At that time, nobody was familiar with flea markets. At that time, everybody said, ah, Tom, forget about this concept. Koreans always want to buy their things new. They couldn't see the, let's say, the economic second circle value of products behind, which is like the foundation in Europe or also in America or something. It makes no sense to throw it away just like because you don't wear it anymore. So somebody else can buy it for a lower money and wear it even longer than you worn it. So this is an economic circle and very eco-friendly environment process and event. So now, after 5 or 6 years, there are plenty of flea markets. Even exactly the same concept, like night flea markets in Busan, in Gwangju, in Daegu. I can see it everywhere. It was not there before. So here, one more time again, Platoon, cultural development. That's our mother and our main vision and mission here. And with this flea market, worked pretty well out what we wanted to bring in. And we could demonstrate that also Koreans will love to buy things on flea markets.
You just mentioned that the building was made out of containers, and actually for this innovative design in South Korea, you got the Korean Architecture Prize in 2009. How did that come about? Not just the prize, but actually the concept behind the building itself.
I think I mentioned also in the beginning that the concept of Platoon was to occupy empty spaces, and we came up with the container idea from the beginning. So I have renderings still in my office from 1999, where we start like rendering container structures into empty slots or gaps. And 2 years later, we did it the first time in Berlin with the first two containers, and then three container, a fourth one as a swimming pool. We occupied the whole area and the buildings get bigger and bigger and bigger. So it was clearly our branding concept of Platoon to always use cargo containers. Maybe a bit of a side story here is also like, you know, if you imagine right now at this moment, I guess there will be hundred thousands of containers around the globe exchanging culture, cultural goods, even art from one country to the other. So it's a metaphor for cultural exchange in the end as well. So we thought nothing fits better than using this container structure and demonstrate temporary architecture, contemporary art and artist, and cultural exchange in the end. That was the reason why we choose container. And of course, it's a flexibility as well. As I said, using empty spaces in Berlin, now we will move for the fourth time within 12 years. We will move from one space to the other, and we always take our containers to the next space. That's the proposition in terms of, let's say, really concrete buildings which you hardly can move anymore. But the container structure, especially the one in Berlin, is built from the beginning to be removed, reassembled and built up on a different space again.
So when you decided to open the Kunsthalle in Seoul, why Seoul? I mean, there's Beijing just next door, there's Tokyo as well, there's even Taipei. Asia has a lot of big cities. Why Seoul?
This is a question I get 100 times in the past years. For us, it was pretty, in the end, I can say, it's easy. In a nutshell, Korea is the epic center of Asia. So it's really like in the middle of Asia. So it spreads to Japan, to China, down to Southeast Asia as well. So there was always a highly attention on Korea when we came 2006, 7 and 8. Then we have a huge German-Korean friendship. I don't know if you're familiar about that, but after the war, end of the 60s, beginning of the 70s, Germany was a big supporter of Korea. We had this special workers agreement, so we invited miners and nurses early 70s to come to Germany. We paid them 1 year salary in advance so they could send the money back to the poor families here in Korea. We gave a huge credit to the government to build the first streets in this country. So there was a really a strong relationship between Korea and Germany. And that's what we felt as well when we came as a German to Korea. I was never more welcomed in a foreign country than in Korea. They simply love the Germans. They love our culture, they love our products, everything around. One more reason was at the time, 2007, 2008, I mean, Korea was really like upcoming, like the rising star of economics here. So they made a lot of money. The brands came up, Hyundai, Kia, Samsung, LG, all these big players becoming more and more bigger and bigger and bigger. So it was a little bit easier to find the right support for our project. For example, in Japan, like in Tokyo, we've been to Tokyo several times. It's already so overloaded at the time with cultural activities, with foreign exchange programs and nightlife and subculture. It was already crazy. And on the other hand, unpayable. So having a slot of 1,000 square meters downtown in Shibuya or Roppongi is pretty impossible. They offered us places outside in Yokohama, which is still big, but wasn't interesting for us. Then there was this kind of lifestyle, we figured, within the Asian people, that the Koreans, they were pretty open-minded. They were already Western-orientated, Western-educated here as well. So we always felt they have already a much more open mind than, for example, Chinese people. Don't say anything negatively about Chinese people, but at that time, China was a totally different state. Yeah. So for us, the Koreans were the Italians of Asia. Lifestyle, fashion, food, good looking, funny. We liked the sense of humor, which is very important for us because humor is something where we come from. And finding humor in Japan or in China was always a bit difficult. Either they couldn't share our humor. And secondly, it was always like, is it now the first face or the second face they show you? You know what I mean? I mean, it's like you could never really see the real person in front of you. Japanese people are so close and they always show up with the second face. You never know, do they laughing with you or laughing about you? And then last but not least, we met the right people from the beginning. So we came the first time and we've been introduced to really like players in this country. Culture players, brand players, artist players, governmental, institutional players. They all wanted to support us. So it was in the end pretty easy to decide. Let's do it in Seoul and not in Tokyo and Beijing. And last but not least, I mean, 2006, 2007, there was nothing in Seoul where we were interested in. So we felt extremely that this city needs a project like us.
You already mentioned a few times subculture, but before discussing subculture any further, what is mainstream culture? What is this hegemonic culture that exists and that you're trying to oppose?
Okay, mainstream for us is like everything what is kind of established already, even which is exhibited in museums. If there's like a name, like a blah, blah museum or museum of blah, 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 we were not really interested into it anymore because established artists charging a lot of money for their art and they're doing it since 30 years. So there's a whole industry and system behind which we were never interested in. So mainstream is everything what is tightly connected to commercial consumerism and capital. That's the three main interests of mainstream and the fine art. We were interested only in the new upcoming talents, no matter if they would make it as an artist in the future or not. We were interested, what are you doing right now? What is new here? What is the new approach, the new skill or new style? What is cool and what is also like got a potential of social criticism, society's criticism? And stuff like that. That's what we are interested in. Of course, you can find it more in 20 years, young brains and people, rather than 50 or 60 years old artists who made their arrangement already with buyers, collectors, museums.
Is it fair to say that there is a Marxist subtext to Platoon and this general philosophy it has?
Yeah. Yeah, I would say yes. I would definitely say yes. Brands, for us, they have a huge responsibility in this society. And we understand that brands need to communicate with either the existing customers or consumers or the future consumers. That's legit. It's market needs and marketing. So, but what we didn't like is the approach of brands. So the message within the commercial break. So beginning of 2000, when we started, TV was already dead in Europe for sure. Everything went into the web. TV is becoming more and more the media for the poor. Brands acting with very stupid commercials, 30 seconds messages, which are totally stupid. So we always had this example of the white line of fresh laundries. So it's getting more white than white and whiter and whiter. And the line goes now twice around the globe for the amount of laundry you can wash with one washing powder. So it was really a stupid advertising. And more pops up in this direction. So what happened? People zapped. From the moment advertising comes, boom. They zapped or went to the toilet, out. Totally blocked. And we always dreamed of a TV commercial break where I see 10 TV spots, which I really want to see. Because they give me something. They pose a question, irritates me, and animates me to think about something. So it's a kind of help of life, you know, some really like useful tips, thoughts and stuff where we think brands should step into. I don't know if you're familiar with the campaign end of the 90s or middle of the 90s. And I still think it's a wonderful, wonderful example for brand communication and marketing. It was the Benetton campaign in the middle of the 90s with Olivieri Toscani. He was the photographer. And they shot the animals ruined with oil from the oil digging accidents. They shot pictures from shooting Bosnia-Herzegovina war people, and they put it on the billboard to make aware about real problems in the world, and that Benetton wants to fight against it, and that they do all their efforts in terms of marketing, spending and stuff to do something good with this and let the people know there's something wrong out there, and let's all together think about it, consider it and do something against it. So they use a lot of millions of dollars to make aware about the social issues and general problems of the world. That's where we thought like, wow, that's cool. Benetton, they didn't sold more sweaters because of that. The opposite was the sales went down after that. But they made a statement here as a big brand, as a global brand, what could be content for advertisings and messages. And you can see now it's coming more and more. A lot of more lifestyle-orientated brands who are really in the need to get in touch with the people around 20 or even younger. They need to come up with really things where people can think about it. Not stupid stuff anymore. A lot of other brands, they're trying really to come up with some more than a classic 30 seconds advertising.
What would you say Korean mainstream culture
needs
to hear? What are the messages that the brands should be saying in South Korea?
In South Korea? Yes. Wow. You know, unfortunately, I don't look so much commercials here. I don't watch so much commercials here. I just imagine now the brands I see, which comes to my mind here in Korea, they should come back to authenticity. I think that's the key word here. It's not everything like so colorful, so shiny, and everything popped up and yeah, and fun and stuff like this. They should also become a little bit more authentic and start telling stories which are the truth, which are real, and don't build up so much hyper-realistic pictures in the consumer's mind here in Korea. I think we are in the Western world, like Middle Europe and stuff, we are pretty 10-15 years ahead if it comes to communication, marketing and advertising. I can see a lot of things which happens right now here happens 15 years ago in Germany. Let's say insurance companies, food companies and stuff like this. So they are still on this shiny road to heaven. But I think they have to change a little bit in this field. How they should do it, I mean, I can't give you now the solution for it. But what I see when I watch TV and what I can understand so far, there is a lot of cheesy, family cheesy stuff. We like focused on families like mom, dad, one kid, maximum two kids. Always this own apartment, own house, own Samsung bank and own Samsung insurance company and so on and so on. I think there should be a little bit more international and open also the style a little bit more. It looks often really Ajumma style what they're doing and still thinking that they come through with the message in their specific target group. But I think also here in Korea, TV goes down. As I said, the media usage went totally into the web. So who is watching TV these days anymore? It's like the lower percentage of the society. Yeah.
Is that why you chose to locate the Kunsthalle in Gangnam? Gangnam is a district that obviously became really famous because of Psy's song about the rich Korean who live there and are admittedly quite superficial. Is that why you chose this place?
Absolutely, absolutely. So when we came to Korea first time and we figured out and researched, we said, okay, if we do this Platoon Kunsthalle here in Seoul, then there's only one place, it's Gangnam. It's Gangnam because there is this established rich lifestyle and we wanted to show them something what is totally unexpected. Totally unexpected. And it pretty worked well out. From the moment we had a container building which also like looked from outside like a block, like a steel block, some windows, but it was really, really close, really bold. Yeah, containers downtown in Gangnam on the most expensive ground you can find in Gangnam. Dosan Sagori, around the corner, the property is easy. It's really expensive. And all these established galleries, museums around us, brands, rich people. We wanted to give a statement here. Yeah. And so from the moment we opened, these people passed by. And I tell you, everybody had a look. Everybody. We had everybody in the house. And if I say everybody, it was everybody. So all the rich people, the really rich people, government, institutional people, they were all there. And they were all so surprised. Because once you enter the building, it opens to yourself really like in a nice open space where you can really breathe. And then you see interesting content. Even it was just like really subculture related, but also a 65 years old chaebol understand what we are doing there. So we made the best experiences in terms of having this location there. And then of course also the media, it was a PR masterpiece in the end, because from the moment we opened it, everybody wanted to know what the heck is going on there. What are they doing there? So we had all medias in the house, nationally, internationally, then award prizes, so Korean Architecture Association. We didn't even have to apply. You know, they came to us and said, we want you to have this prize. It's out of over 1,000 buildings. They choose our building as the most unique building in Korea. Container building. So, and then we won a German Design Prize, a Red Dot Design Award, most beautiful buildings in Gangnam. So everybody started like loving the building because it was so new, the architectural concept. But everybody liked it, loved it, and then they started like copying it. Soon units came out specialized on container buildings. We did a second building in Gwangju, and then now we have a container Kunsthalle in Pusan in Gwangju. Daegu invited us to discuss a place with them and so on and so on. So now the container is established as a tool. Shops out of container, pop-up stores and everything coming out of containers. And then, as I said, all brands wanted to have a show there. Not only lifestyle-orientated brands like Adidas, Nike or something like this. It's young, but no, also the big ones. Ferrari, Lamborghini, Tag Heuer, Chanel, Dior. Everybody used this venue and customized it, decorated it for themselves and their customers, and then invited their people, and they all had a wonderful event there. So it was also flexible in use, this space. Yeah. So you can create everything inside. It's hard to find in Gangnam. usually you can book a ballroom at a residence hotel or Hyatt or something. So it's really limited with spaces. Now it becomes a bit better, but 2009, 2010, it was always like the best alternative like to do a bigger event was always the Kunsthalle.
Let me play the devil's advocate for a while. Koreans are definitely fashionable, but they also really, really, really like trends. Are you sure that the Kunsthalle was not actually a very trendy place for, let's say, a year or two, but then like so many other trends get forgotten very easily? Isn't that maybe a fear in this type of project?
No, I would say over a course of nearly 7 years, I would say, of course, in the beginning it was trendy. Everybody heard about this venue and everybody wants to go there, wants to see it. It was a trend to go there. But what we did is like we established the space, the place with a constant program over the year with meaningful program, meaningful artists from Korea, but also international artists. So we had shows, we brought in formats which Korean creatives never saw before. So we established the space as a creative and cultural hub and not at a trendy space anymore. Trendy people, of course, they move on 1 year here, the next year there and stuff. But that was never, let's say, the core community we built it up around us. It was really serious people with a sustainable approach in their own life. As I said, creatives or artists who got a vision to do something and who know that it takes time to create something or to develop yourself. So we had artists which we invited in the beginning 2009 and then we brought them back in 2013 just to show their own way, you know, their own development again to our audience. So there was a lot of really like meaningful content from our side. So therefore, I would say not a trendy venue, it's really like an established cultural hub rather than a trendy venue.
We talked a lot about subculture, but is that singular or plural? When you think about subculture, do you really mean something specific or can it mean different things?
Oh, I think it can mean totally different things. We are interested in the creative aspect of subculture, but what does it mean creative? I mean, the whole creative industry is related to subculture, and this could be a writer who start like developing his first writing skills and working on his first essay or even a book or something. But this could be a musician composing something totally new, strange, different, and with an orchestra you never saw before. Or it could be a movie director who comes up with new movie skills which nobody used before. Or it's a media artist or video installation artist, or it's a dance performance. So it's, of course, in a wide field of creative industry, we can find subculture. Defining subculture is really a bit difficult. Everybody got his own understanding of it. And there is also not really like a definition. It's broad. It's not really fixable. What does it mean, subculture? As I said, for us, it was always like the young, new, experimental ways of any kind of creatives to express themselves and to convey any kind of stories or pictures behind.
What would you say, in your experience, characterizes South Korean creativity? Is there anything that makes it unique compared to, let's say, Berlin's or in the US or in France? What makes it Korean?
Okay, so then let me break it down from that, because also one of the reasons why we did it in Korea and what was always a kind of story for us when we were asked about the creativity in Korea. So we still think that Korea got the potential to take over the lead in terms of the most creative country in Asia. So they can hold the big flag, we are the most creatives in Asia, if they make it right. Now, since we know everybody's in creative economies, yeah, the whole government, president, everybody is like, this is important. We're talking about that since 10 years, that this is important to be developed. But now the new government, they realized it slowly but surely. So from the big idea, narrow it down. So what is it? What could make the Koreans being the leader in terms of creativity here in Asia, but also abroad? Of course, fashion. Fashion comes also from subculture, from young, creative, freaky fashion students who go their own way and developing a brand or a line, a fashion line, a label, which you never saw before in Korea. Music. K-pop is not really subculture related music, but in terms of creativity, K-pop plays a big role for this country in Southeast Asia and more in the Western world. And beside K-pop, of course, we have other music streams and styles. So let's say electronic music. I think Korea got a nice potential here. I met a lot of producers here. Hip-hop music, Korean hip-hop is not K-pop, it's Korean hip-hop. They can make the bridge, and Tiger JK and other people there are already showing us that you can be also an international influencer with your music rooted in the Korean music culture. So there's music, there's architecture and design, and more art. I can see that if you go to Berlin these days, it's pretty hard to find a gallery who either never exhibited a Korean artist or are not planning to exhibit a Korean artist. So we have a lot of Korean interesting artists coming bigger and bigger. That's what I can say. Actually, it's still very established fine art, but I can see there's a new breed of young artists coming up more and more. Vaki. She was one of our first artists in residences here in Seoul, 2009. She moved in at the second person in one of our studios. And now 6 or 7 years later, I can say she made really a nice way. She did more and more solo exhibitions here. Now she got a new space. She got exhibitions in Berlin. We had an exchange program with her as well. And so she's becoming more and more known. And there are some others as well. So I can see that this young subculture related freaks and kids we supported from the beginning, that they are now making the next step and getting a bit more on the radar of international galleries and any kind of art institutions.
What are the future developments you see in South Korean culture? What will happen, in your opinion, in 5, 10, 15 years? What's next and what should we be looking forward to?
We do a lot more and more trend and lifestyle researches in this country in the name of brands or other institutions. And I can see this trend of individualism, rather having your small own shop than a career at Samsung, or an artist's career than a lawyer career or something. So people more and more recognize that there's something more than big corporate structures. I'm living in Gyeonggi-dang. That's why I can see it a little bit, like what happens actually on my hill, like Gyeonggi-dang, Haebangcheong, Noksapyeong, even Itaewon. You can see more and more young Korean shops opening, young creatives, young fashion designer, young artists, young, I don't know, any kind of, they're taking over their lives by themselves. They're tired on following the same structure like their parents did. Of course, 40 years ago, it was the biggest to be hired by Hyundai, Samsung or Kia, and then they take care of until the rest of your life of you. You don't even have to take care of another bank or insurance company or housing. Samsung is taking care of you for the rest of your life. That's something what for their parents was good. They made their prosperity out of it, a good life, and could finance the education for the kids and stuff like this. But now kids or young people, they want something new, something more. So I can see within the next 10 years, of course, we have a huge extension into small companies, 3, 4, 5 people, shops, design studios, photo studios, will be the first for the fashion studio. So all this creative industry will come more important here. And if the government is doing a good job, we'll see in terms of how they're going to push now and promote and support young creative economy, which is actually, unfortunately, really focused on IT business and startup business. And they should extend it a little bit more. It's too much of a focus for me. But I think this will also find a way. With the next government, it will adjust to people who are not following, let's say, startup or IT business. So that's what I can say. It will be a new trend, a new breed of younger, more creative people who wants to take care of their life by themselves. Which brings me back to one statement I had before, that Koreans can take this creative lead in Asia, and therefore it needs to be developed more into like smaller companies who are working then a bit more international. So I can see absolutely a more international workflow for these people and connections. That's one of the biggest trends in the future. You can see it now. The big companies, they are trying really hard to do so, but still lacking here. But this will be, of course, the most important move for whole Korea and the whole economy here, to think more on a global perspective and open themselves to a more international network. Gone are the days where you live on your peninsula here, surrounded by the sea and North Korea, and doing your own stuff. That's gone. They need to have international relationships and collaborations, and they need to understand how other markets are working and stuff like this. So this will be absolutely something what I can see for Korea, more internationality. Creativity ahead, and artists, they should just simply go like they now start to go. Since 6, 7, 8 years, I can see they really come into life and learn to walk. Young creatives, young artists, they more and more find their own communities. The city is also a bit more open for young artists. So let's say street art, you know, in Germany, in Berlin, it's one of the most popular reasons why we have international visitors, because of our street art. And I can see the city is more and more open to that, to exhibit via the streets their own creatives and artists. So we can see more and more, let's say, areas which are open more for street artists. Even government ask artists to do something here, to make something wonderful out of boring walls or something like this, and makes the city more beautiful. And if you, I'm not talking about tagging or shitty stuff, I'm talking about really like nice things, which makes the city more interesting to walk through. And Berlin is the biggest open-air gallery in the world, I would say. You can go wherever you want. You can always find some nice pieces, interesting pieces from young, unknown artists, but also, of course, very well-known artists. So for them, the first stage is always like enter the street. Show it randomly on the street to random audiences. That's how they gain their first experience and feedbacks on that. And then they move on and then go to galleries and then to museums and to big exhibitions and stuff like that. And of course, I mean, I know if I can talk about this here, but of course in 10 years, I see this country already reunified. And this is the final state of this whole country. I had this vision of being the most creative here in Asia as a Korean, and imagine they would even be reunified and have all the natural resources as well and their own peace. I think then they can really be a big powerful state in Asia, taking even over, let's say, control functions in terms of peace. So let's say if they will be reunited, the militaries united, they can take over, not a controlling position, that's not what I mean, but they can help other countries around here in Asia, and they could be a power to make Asia safe, like the NATO in Europe or something like that.
To conclude, what is Platoon working on right now and what is coming next?
Okay, so in terms of our consulting business, we work since 1 year for a German car brand, which is Mercedes-Benz in this country. So we worked on a repositioning campaign and strategy. So we, over a long process of researching and the market and understanding the market and the competitors and stuff, we developed in the positioning of this brand in Korea, getting in touch with a much younger audience in the future. And therefore, we developed a campaign, which is called hashtag the best in my life. And we launched recently, some weeks ago, the first movie material, which we use on social media and on other online medias, even cinema, print and stuff. So it's a campaign about the young new breed of creatives in Korea. A campaign about the new modern women and young families and creative professionals and trendsetters and progressive executives in this country. So these different target groups we are interested in and start a conversation, building up a conversation with them. That's something related to our agency work here in Korea. And the second thing is that we actually preparing a new show, a new pop-up Platoon Kunsthalle in Mexico City. There is a German-Mexican culture year, start next year May, and we were asked by the government to be a part of it. So actually we are in heavy talks with the, for example, the Goethe Institute Mexico City, so the Cultural Institute of Germany, our foreign ministry, and our connections in Mexico City already. That's the second hot project we are working on right now, part of the team in Berlin and part of the team here in Seoul. We're going to join forces to build up the Mexico City show from January on.
Tom Buschmann, thank you so much for your time.
You're welcome. It was a pleasure to be here.
This was Korea and the World. To make sure you don't miss our next episode, bookmark our website, koreaandtheworld.org, subscribe to our podcast on iTunes, and follow us on Facebook and Twitter.